Kings-Fetha Nagast, the law of the kings.
In the name of God, one in divinity and three in persons and in being. Chapter 1, the church and what concerns it. A church is a house of prayer. A church shall be built only with the permission of the bishop. If someone dares to do otherwise, mass shall never be said in it. And if a priest dares do it and celebrates mass, he shall be removed from his office. Chapters 15 and 30 of the Didascalia establish the way in which a church should be constructed and what its internal arrangement should be. It must be lighted with many lamps in the likeness of heaven, especially during the reading from verses of the holy books, such as the epistles of St. Paul the Apostle, the Acts of the Apostles, and the Gospel of the Kingdom of Heaven. Must it be brilliantly lighted? It shall be lighted with wax and with lamps when the bishop consecrates the tabet on the altar. During the consecration, seven priests shall be with him, and he shall make the sign of the cross on the tabet with the chrism, which is the oil of happiness, as it is the seal of God. After this has been done, the sacred mysteries may be celebrated in the church. The Gospel of St. John the Divine shall be read on the altar. Mass shall not be celebrated except when the priest with their chief and all the deacons are gathered to attend, so that it may be an honor and a joy. If the altar breaks or is transferred elsewhere, it shall be consecrated again. The tabet shall be such that it can be transferred from one place to another, like the stone of the children of Israel, which could be transferred from one place to another. The dust which is swept from the sanctuary shall be thrown into a running river. No man shall trade in consecrated objects belonging to a church, such as vessels made either of gold or of silver, for it would be a transgression of the law. If one does so, he shall be driven away from the church after being punished. The bishop shall say mass in his house if infidels prevail again over the Christians and prevent them from going to church. If they are unable to gather in a house or in a church, each one shall say the psalms, read, and pray alone at the place where he finds himself. In normal times, mass shall not be celebrated in the house of the bishop, nor in the house of a member of the faithful, but only in a consecrated church. Whoever trespasses against the church and does in his house things which should be done nowhere else but in church shall be excommunicated. No one shall stay to carry on a conversation at the place where the altar is located. One may stay there only to pray and worship before the altar. No one but priests may enter the place where the altar is located to receive the Holy Eucharist. No one may invite others to sit at a banquet or to eat in the house of God and his saintly tabet. Do not profane the church of God by drinking and eating inside it, and do not humiliate those who have nothing to eat or drink by getting drunk while they stay hungry. Women are not allowed to enter the sanctuary nor to pray in it. Chapter 2. The Divine Books, which must be accepted by the Holy Church, and which are 81 in number. The sacred books accepted by the faithful in the church are the books of the Old Testament, that is, the Law, Pentateuch, 5 books, 1 book of Joshua, the son of Nun, the book of Judges, the book of Ruth, the book of Judith, the books of the Kings, 4 in number, of which the first and the second form 1 book, and similarly the third and fourth form another book, 2 books of Paraleponemum, 2 books of Ezra the scribe, the book of Esther, the book of Tobias, Maccabees, 2 books, the book of Job, the Psalms of David, 1 book, 5 books of Wisdom of Solomon, that is, Proverbs, Kohelet, the Song of Songs, Wisdom, Wisdom of Bagur, 16 books of the prophets, of whom the greater ones are 4, namely Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, and Daniel, and the lesser ones are 12, to wit, Hosea, Amos, Micah, Joel, Obadiah, Jonah, Nahum, Habakkuk, Zephaniah, Haggai, Zechariah, and Malachi. Besides these, there are the wisdoms of Jesus, the son of Sirach, for the education of boys, and also the book of Joseph, the Korian, which is another book of Maccabees. Chapter 3, Baptism and Those Who Embrace the Faith. Men and women, children and the aged must all be baptized, for our Lord, may he be praised, has said, unless a man is born again of water and of the Holy Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. He also said to his disciples, go and teach all nations, baptize them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And the canons enacted for this purpose are, only a bishop or a priest shall baptize. The deacons shall assist them. No one shall accept a bribe to baptize another, nor shall anyone sell for a price the gift of the Holy Spirit. Women shall not baptize anyone. If someone is baptized by heretics, he is not a member of the faithful. Men shall not stand as godfathers to women, nor women shall stand as godmothers to men, but the males shall stand to the males and the females to the females. Baptism shall be administered at a running stream or in water that runs in the baptistery. In case of necessity, the water drawn elsewhere shall be poured into the baptistery. Our immersion in water symbolizes our association with the death of Christ, and our coming out of the water symbolizes our resurrection with him. If the required quantity of water, that is, enough water to cover the head of the one who is to be baptized, is not available, 3 handfuls of water shall be taken, and his head shall be washed in the name of the Trinity. And he who can receive baptism, when the time to receive this privilege arrives, shall not defer it until tomorrow. One shall not delay baptism to wait for the coming of parents or friends, nor procrastinate on account of some dress of which one wants to make show. None should wait for the coming of the patriarch, the metropolitan, the bishop, of a specific priest to administer the baptism. Rather, one should wait only for a minister who is entitled to administer the sacrament of baptism, since the power of baptism is one and equal. What is required for its proper administration is that the priest who baptizes be not alien to the church, that is, a heretic, or one whose rebellion is notorious. The rich man shall not refuse to be baptized together with the poor, nor a master with a slave. They shall be undressed, and the baby shall be baptized first. Those who can talk shall speak for themselves. But if they are such that they cannot talk, the parents or some relative shall speak on their behalf. After the babies, the men shall be baptized, and then the women, with their hair untied and without wearing any gold ornaments on their hands, nor one shall wear anything when he is immersed in the water. Those who are baptized shall wash themselves with water on the 5th day of the holy week and shall eat. They shall fast only the Holy Friday. If a woman is menstruating, she shall wait until she is pure. On the Holy Saturday, the bishop shall gather those who are to be baptized and command them to turn their heads toward the east. He shall extend his hand over them and pray. After he has made them swear their renunciation of the devil, he shall blow on their faces and make the sign of the cross on their members, so that they may be diligent in every saintly thing and prayer. At cock crow, they shall be placed near the water of the baptistery, and the bishop shall pray over the blessed oil, by which the oath renouncing the devil is sworn. He shall give it to a priest, who will stand at his left and pray over the blessed oil, which is the oil of thanksgiving. Then he shall give it to another priest and make him stand at his right. The one who is being baptized shall turn his face from the east to the west and shall deny the devil. A priest shall take his right hand and shall turn his face eastwards towards the water. Before stepping into the water, he shall confess that he is a believer in the Father, in the Son, and in the Holy Spirit. Thus all shall be baptized, and then they shall receive the Eucharist. They, as well as those who fasted together with them, shall taste nothing before taking the holy mystery, but at the end of the Mass they may eat what they wish. They shall receive the Eucharist before other people do. Gloss 1. From the Canons, a clergyman who has a son aged 1 year or more and does not have him baptized shall be forbidden to perform his priestly service. A layman who omits to do this shall be expelled and prevented from receiving the Eucharist until he has his son baptized. Pregnant women shall not be prevented from being baptized whenever they wish. The baptism shall not benefit both the mother and the unborn child. Every person must profess his faith individually. Gloss 2. An additional canon says that if it is feared that a child will die before the purification of its mother from the blood of confinement, he shall be brought to church by another person and baptized. The bishop shall anoint the head of the woman, and the deaconess shall anoint the remaining part of the body, because it is not proper for a man to look at the nakedness of a woman. In the Coptic Church, this law is laid down in a separate book on baptism, which is compiled from the canons and deals only with Christian baptism and with the prayers which are used in it. Baptism is to be administered according to that book, and one must observe its rules scrupulously. The conduct of the person who is preparing himself to be baptized shall be examined. During the instruction given to those who are preparing for baptism, one shall inquire about their lives by asking them if they have done good deeds, and if those who have brought them for baptism testify that they have done so, they shall be allowed to hear the word of the gospel from the day they are brought. And when the day of their baptism arrives, the bishop shall make all the witnesses swear one by one, so he may know that those to be baptized are pure. If one is found not to be pure, he shall be separated from the others and rejected, because he has not heard the divine word with faith. Chapter 4, Patriarchs. Most of the provisions dealing with bishops hold good for patriarchs as well, because the latter are called the great and the first among the bishops, or, in other canons, the chiefs of the bishops. This chapter is divided into two parts. One is taken from various books, and the other is arrived at by reasoning. Part 1, taken from various books. Patriarchs are the successors of Christ and his apostles, to whom Christ said, "He that receives you receives me." And the power of a patriarch over Christians is like the princedom of Moses over the Israelites. The council of the saintly fathers of Nicaea commanded that there must be only 4 patriarchs in the world at one time. Like the 4 books of the gospel, the 4 rivers, the 4 orders of the world, the 4 directions of the world, the 4 winds, and the 4 elements of creation. The chief and prince among them must be the one who occupies the See of Peter, that is, the See of Rome, in accordance with what the apostles commanded. After him comes the one who occupies the See of Alexandria, the Great, which is the See of Mark. The 3rd patriarch is the one who occupies the See of Ephesus, the See of John the theologian, and the 4th is the one who occupies the See of Antioch, which is also the See of Peter. The bishops are spread over the world, each under the authority of one of these 4 patriarchs. Each metropolitan of the great cities shall consecrate the bishops of the province under his jurisdiction, but none of his bishops may consecrate him as metropolitan because he is superior to them. Each one shall restrict himself to his jurisdiction, and no one shall usurp the jurisdiction of another. The council shall excommunicate whosoever transgresses this law laid down by us. The Patriarchate of Ephesus shall pass to the imperial city of Constantinople, so that it may be an honor to the kings and the priests together. The bishop of Ephesus shall be respected and shall not be despised, because the patriarchal dignity which he had been taken away from him. He shall be honored with the great name of Kotolika, which is a name given to chiefs. He who occupies the See of Thessalonica shall be honored because he deserves it. The bishop of Jerusalem shall not be subject to another bishop. Rather, he shall be exalted and honored because he is appointed over the holy city, and because the cross of our Lord, Jesus Christus, and the place of his resurrection are in his hands. Honor is also due to the bishop who occupies the See of Baghdad, that is, Seleucia, which is in the east and is called the city of Mediam. He also shall be honored with the name of chief, and as of now shall be permitted to consecrate metropolitans, just as the patriarchs do, This is to spare the Orientals the necessity of going to the Patriarch of Antioch and returning from him. The Patriarch of Antioch has indeed given his consent to this, as he was requested by the council not to regret the fact that jurisdiction over the East was taken away from him. The council requested this to bring peace to the Christians of Persia. If it becomes necessary for the bishops to hold a council in Roman territory, and if the titular of Seleucia, known as the city of Baghdad, which was originally called Sabur and is called Midyan today, participates in this council, he shall during the session be more exalted and honored than all the other metropolitans of the Roman Empire, because he bears the title of Patriarch in the East. His chair shall be the seventh in rank, next to the bishops of Jerusalem. The council shall excommunicate anyone who transgresses this rule. The great council may not assemble at Seleucia to promulgate laws without the permission of the Patriarch of Antioch, because although the Oriental chief have the rank of Patriarch because he has asked to become the equal of the other Patriarchs, the Orientals, however, do not have the power to loosen and to bind law of the Church, to add to it or to repeal existing laws of their own desire. In everything, they are subject to the superiors and the assembly of patriarchs. Gloss 3. After this session, the Patriarchate of Ephesus was given to the one who occupies the See of Constantinople, who was placed second in rank and was third after the Patriarch of Alexandria. As for the Ethiopians, a patriarch shall not be appointed from among their learned men, nor can they appoint one by their own will. Their metropolitan is subject to the holder of the See of Alexandria, who is entitled to appoint over them a chief who hails from his region and is under his jurisdiction. And when the said metropolitan is appointed with the title given to the chief, he is not to be permitted to consecrate other metropolitans as the other patriarchs do. He shall only be honored with the name of patriarch without enjoying the power of a patriarch. And if it becomes necessary to hold a council in Roman territory, and if the metropolitan of Ethiopia takes part, he shall be seated 8, next to the titular of Seleucia, which is one of the cities within the boundaries in which Babylon, Iraq, and the kingdom of Sabir are found. The metropolitan of Ethiopia comes in rank after that of Seleucia because the latter is permitted to consecrate bishops for his own country, but neither is permitted to be appointed by the will of the bishops under his jurisdiction. The patriarch shall watch over all work done and orders made by his metropolitans and bishops in the countries over which they are appointed. If he discovers something improper, he shall change it and make it conform with what appears proper to him, since he is like the father of all metropolitans and bishops, and they are his children. The metropolitan appointed over the bishops shall be honored as the elder brother appointed over his brothers, and must be obeyed so that his rule and administration will be good. The patriarch in his power is like a father over his children, and as a patriarch has authority and power over those who are under him, so also the titular of Rome has power over all other patriarchs, because he is the chief, as was Peter, who had power over all Christian chiefs and the community of Christian men in his capacity as the vicar of Christ, our Lord, upon his people and his churches. The bishops of every city shall gather with their metropolitan twice a year to examine with him what is to be done and to see him, so that when the terrible day of judgment arrives, they can give a valid account of office to which they were appointed. And similarly, the metropolitans and the bishops shall gather with their patriarch once a year, as did the judges of the Israelites used to report their difficulties to Moses. The election of a patriarch shall take place only in the presence of the bishops and the metropolitan, who is the archbishop. If there is a dispute about his election, it shall be settled in accordance with the advice of the majority of them, and the one who is fit shall be appointed over them. Each city and village, big or small, under the jurisdiction of the patriarch, shall be obligated to give an offering to the patriarch in proportion to what the city or village can afford to give. And that offering shall be sent to him every year to be a help to him. Failure to observe the provision of this chapter does not entail excommunication. The Metropolitan and his bishops are not allowed to inquire into the guilt of a bishop under the Metropolitan's jurisdiction, nor can they judge him nor accept his repentance without leave of the Patriarch and without his knowledge and command. No charge brought against a Patriarch by one of the Metropolitans under his jurisdiction shall be accepted, or if a Patriarch is guilty of some offense, no proceeding shall take place unless one of his three fellow Patriarchs takes part in the accusation and in the inquiry into the matter. No one of the three Patriarchs may authorize another accuser to proceed against the accused Patriarch, nor shall any of the three support an accuser without the authorization of a fellow Patriarch and without inquiring himself into the matter as said earlier. No Patriarch, Metropolitan, or Bishop is allowed to loosen what another of equal rank has done except after the latter's death. But the Patriarch is permitted, after having inquired into the matter, to loosen what Metropolitan and Bishops have done, if he deems that so doing is good, for he is the master of the house, honored above them and over all. When a Metropolitan appoints a Bishop, he shall send a Corepiscopus with him, so that he may introduce him into his city and his church, and enthrone him on the first day he occupies his see. After the bishop dwells in his city for 3 months, he shall go to the Metropolitan to visit and greet him, and the Metropolitan shall command the Corepiscopus, or the archpriest, or the archdeacon, to test the bishop on the laws of bishops, and see if he has fulfilled all the prescriptions. If they find that he has fully observed them, then the Metropolitan shall ratify his appointment, and shall give him power to rule over his diocese. Thenceforth his orders shall be observed. The Metropolitans must do the same with their Patriarchs. Woe to him who transgresses this provision! The council will excommunicate him. No bishop who is under the jurisdiction of a Metropolitan shall ask permission directly from the Patriarch in any matter, but shall do so only with the permission of his Metropolitan and after informing him of it. No Metropolitan or Bishop shall attempt to see the King without the permission of the Patriarch. The Council will excommunicate anyone who transgresses this. The Bishops of every country must know their chief and must accept him as their superior. They shall not do anything either great or little except with his advice, nor any their chiefs do any important thing without the advice of all his Bishops. Thus they shall remain in full accord. Part 2, arrived at by reasoning. The Patriarchate stands in the place of Christ in the world to preserve the faith and to rule the faithful in accordance with spiritual laws. And the Patriarch's appointment, which helps to preserve the precepts of the Church, is imposed on the faithful and binding on all of them. This is shown by the law and custom. The first is evident from what is laid down in the preceding canons. The second is also evident because it is natural custom or intelligent persons to look for a teacher to lead them to knowledge of the way of justice and doing good. They go forth to a chief who will prohibit them from doing injustice and add justice to the quarrels and enmity which may be among them. If one who is worthy is appointed, then the law is fulfilled, and those who choose him must, in particular, choose a chief for the people. The requirements applicable to those who choose are of three kinds. The first is the knowledge of uprightness, which has been mentioned in the chapter of witnesses. The second is intelligence, through which they can know well who is worthy of this office. The third is that they must have prudence and wisdom to lead them to choose that person, whoever he is, who is the most suitable person for the time. This is the man who appears best suited to enforce the law and to lead them, the man who can rule and show them the true way. As for the qualifications required of the one who is worthy of the patriarchal rank, they are of two kinds. The first are taken from the books and are mentioned in the first chapter on bishops. The second are deduced by reasoning, and they are of four kinds. The first two are perfect conditions of sanity, and health of those parts of the body without which one cannot fulfill the duty of a chief, namely, the organs of sight, hearing, and speaking, the hands, and the legs. The third is absence of illness, which would prevent the patriarch from associating with the people under his jurisdiction, such as sores or leprosy. The fourth is doing good and giving wise advice, having experience and the prudence with which a righteous administration and the good of the administered are well fulfilled. When the electors find many persons bestowed with the qualifications for this office, they must elect one who has more qualifications and whom the people are eager to obey. If such person refuses and does not accept the office, they may choose another from among them. But if there is no one who is worthy to replace him, he must accept. If there are two persons who are equally qualified, the older of the two shall be chosen and appointed. But as being older than another is not a necessary requirement for election, it is lawful even if the younger person is appointed. If one of them is more learned and the other is more experienced in administration, the one whom the exigencies of the time more urgently demand shall be elected as the shepherd of the faithful. If knowledge of the holy books is in greater demand because of the appearance of some heresies, the one who is learned in the holy books shall be appointed. If, on the other hand, a wise administration is required, one who administers well shall be appointed patriarch. If they are equally qualified in every respect and others vie to have their respect friends appointed, the question shall be settled by lot on the altar. It is better, however, to choose people other than these two. If others are available because the competition for the appointment throws discredit upon the contenders, the fact that there is a man of greater perfection does not preclude one of lower rank from being elected, provided that he is a perfect in observing the laws, because greater perfection makes one eligible to election does not assure that one has the necessary requirements. Those who elect a patriarch shall elect a person who is worthy to be a patriarch, and if they refuse, they commit a sin. The rank of patriarch may not be held by two persons simultaneously in one see, and if two are elected in one city, the appointed of the one who was elected first shall be ratified. If the office is given to two persons who are equally worthy, but in two different cities, it shall be held by the one who was appointed first in that place in which by him who was appointed first. When two elections take place simultaneously, both the elected shall be removed, and the electors must choose one of the two who have been appointed first. If they are equally worthy of this office, the matter shall be settled by lot on the altar, and this outcome shall be respected. If one who is vested with rank makes a statement in his will about it, that is, nominates his successor, his will concerning the designation of the patriarchal office is not sufficient. The election shall be held as would normally be done in the case of any other candidate, and his election will depend on his diligence in all his acts, in which there must not be blame. The people must know the name, the face, and the character of the person who is to be appointed. It is not only that only one of them knows him, or that only one is concerned to know his name, his face, etc. Rather, all the electors shall inquire into the character, and the candidate must be one who is constant in the performance of his duties. All shall make inquiries about him, and shall consider whether he meets the following five requirements. The first is that of keeping of the faith as it has been laid down since its establishment and in accordance with the words of the apostles, the accepted counsels, and the saintly fathers whose teachings are accepted by all. Keeping of the faith by uprooting and heresy of those who are separated from faith, and by putting an end to quarrels, so that the faith may be safeguarded from scandals and the people may be kept from falling into error. The second requirement is that of passing judgment with right uprightness and putting an end to disputes. The third is that of giving donation to him who is worthy, without favoring one or slighting another, and of giving it at the right time, neither early nor late. The fourth is that of appointing those who are worthy and of giving alms to the good and the faithful. The fifth requirement is that of taking care of all business and administering the affairs himself. Neither shall he say, it is advantageous to me to authorize others to carry out affairs, nor shall he attempt to draw benefit for himself from anything. Neither shall he have tasty food, nor demand to be the only one served by others, for only God can be served indefinitely. He must consult wise persons on punishments and judgments, and confer with prudent persons before punishing and removing, before binding and loosening. If the patriarch preserves in fulfilling what he must fulfill and preserves in teaching and precepts, his subjects must obey, exalt, honor him, and accept his word as just. If his intelligence is affected by sickness, but there is a chance that he will recover, they shall wait. If there is no hope of recovery, and the time of his illness is short-lived, he shall not be removed from his office. But if his time of sickness is long, he shall be removed from his office. No sick person shall be barred from holding the office of patriarch because of a short illness, provided that he recovers soon after, since one should hold the office only after he recovers completely, and to be removed from office a complete deficiency of health must be apparent in him. If he is bound by the rope of illness or any similar thing, one should wait and hope for his recovery. But if the illness persists, those who elect must replace him with a successor. If he will recover, a healthy man shall replace the patriarch with the consent of the latter until he recovers and returns to his place. But if it is known that he will die and cannot recover, somebody else shall be appointed, as we said before. Complementary matters regarding patriarchs, their appointment, and similar things are found in the canons dealing with patriarchs, with the exception of the Patriarch of Alexandria. Bishops of the place of a patriarchal see may not appoint their patriarch. Chapter 5. Bishops. As said in the Didascalia, a bishop is like a shepherd and must be considered from three points of view. 1. Before his election and consecration. 2. The procedure of his election. 3. After his consecration. The first point of view has three subdivisions. The first, A, lays down under it what conditions he is deemed worthy of being a bishop. The second, B, deals with factors which prevent him from being a bishop. The third, C, deals with matters which render him unworthy, but nevertheless do not disqualify him from the episcopal dignity. A. To be appointed bishop, a person must meet 8 requirements. The first, the second, the third, and the fourth are behavior, character, health, and being elected. Apostle Paul said, there is a faithful saying, if someone desires to be appointed bishop, he desires a good work. A bishop must be blameless and the husband of one wife, sprightly and wise, a comforter, a lover of pilgrims, a teacher not given to much wine, no brawler, but modest. He must not be quarrelsome, nor covetous of riches, but one who rules in his own house well, brings up his children and induces them to obedience and all chastity. If he knows not how to rule his own house well, how shall he rule well the house of the Lord and his church? He shall not be a neophyte, lest being puffed up with pride, he fall into the tortures of the devil. He must also have witnesses in his favor from among those who are against us in the faith, lest he fall into reproach and the snare of the devil. And similarly, we heard our Lord who said, the shepherd who is appointed bishop in the church in every place must be without reproach and error, and must be free of any human injustice, not below 50 years of age, and if he can, he must have a complete knowledge of the doctrine and must be an expert in explaining things. If the see is small, and an elderly or more aged, the man is not available, but there is one who is younger, and it is certified by those who dwell with him that he is worthy of being appointed bishop, and that his youth he showed joyfully, regularly, and wisely, the maturity of an older person, He too must be tested. If he is really what the others said he was, he shall be appointed bishop in peace. But be he young or old, he must be kind, humble, and calm. For God has said through the prophet Isaiah, to whom shall I have respect but to them that are humble and meek, and that tremble in any time at my word? So also he said in the gospel in chapter 5, blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. A bishop shall be merciful because Christ has said, blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. And he shall be peace-loving because the Lord has said, blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called children of God. His conscience shall be good and avoid any evil or injustice because the Lord has said, blessed are the pure of heart, for they shall see God. The bishop must be patient and abide by all good rules. He must not be impatient or a drunkard, wrathful or a lover of wealth and gold. They shall investigate and see whether he is blameless in everything of this world, because it is written, they shall test the one who is appointed to this office so that he may be blameless. He shall not be wrathful because the wisdom says that anger ruins the prudent. He shall be a lover of men because our Lord says, by this shall all men know that you are my disciples if you have love one for the other between you. As for those who choose him, it is necessary that each of them be over 30 years old. The fifth requirement is that the candidate must be a monk from among those who have the holy orders of the altar, or a lawfully married priest who has been praised by the people as a rule. However, it is not good to appoint as a bishop a priest who is lawfully married unless there is no other choice, and then only after he binds himself to observe the sacred canons. This is in accordance with what is said in the canons of Athanasius, Patriarch of Constantinople, and is a rule laid down in our church, that is, that he must be a monk or a priest. The sixth requirement is that he have the approval of the people over whom he is appointed, and the approval of his patriarch, as is the pleasure of the Holy Spirit. A bishop shall be appointed pursuant to an election made by all the people. If someone desires the episcopal office and has the approval of all the people of his city, but not that of the metropolitan of his province, he is not allowed to be bishop without the approval of the metropolitan. If he transgresses this, the council shall excommunicate him, and he shall be deposed from the episcopal office. But if the majority of the people support him, and he receives the approval of the metropolitan and the patriarch, the choice of the majority shall prevail. A bishop shall be appointed with the approval of the metropolitan and the people of the place, and two or three bishops shall consecrate him. Priests, deacons, and others of lower rank shall be ordained by one bishop only, and the only one bishop shall be in communion with them and shall bless them. The seventh requirement is found in the canons of kings. The episcopal rank shall not be given with undue haste before the election takes place on the basis of the candidate's faith, learning, character, and the reputation he enjoys. The candidate shall first be admitted to the priesthood and shall be promptly ranked after rank progressively. If his conduct has been impeccable in all the offices he has held, he shall be appointed bishop. The eighth requirement is that the bishop must be elected by many electors. No one shall be appointed bishop unless 12 persons bear witness of praise for him. If it is a country with only a few faithful in it, and the number of community members does not amount to 12, the number required to elect a bishop, they shall write to the churches in the neighborhood of that place, where there are numerous faithful, so that 3 chosen persons from among the latter may come and carefully advise the former on the persons they deemed worthy to be appointed bishop, and may see if he is of good character, not a blasphemer or a hypocrite, and if he is capable of interpreting the holy books. There are 6 causes which impede a person's appointment as bishop. First, a person possessed by the devil may not be a bishop. Second and third, a blind, deaf, or foolish person may not be appointed a bishop, not because it is a stain on him, but because he cannot execute his duties and the work of the church. Fourth, one who was an infidel and was baptized later in life, or who was a wicked man and has repented, shall not be appointed bishop immediately after his conversion, because he comes from sin. He shall not be a teacher, nor shall the people recognize him as an uprighteous man, unless there is a manifestation from God. Fifth, one who voluntarily makes himself an eunuch shall not be appointed bishop, but one who was made an eunuch by force shall not be disqualified from becoming bishop. Sixth, if someone opposes the appointment and says that the candidate does not deserve to be appointed bishop, the election shall be delayed for 3 months, and the matter regarding him shall be examined in the presence or absence of the opposer. If something is known against the candidate which, according to the canon, bars his appointment, he shall be barred, otherwise he shall be appointed. The man who accused the candidate and could not prove the charge shall, if he is a clergyman, be expelled from the church, and if he is a layman, he shall be duly punished. C. The third deals with causes which render one unworthy, but do not impede his appointment. A one-eyed person or a lame person is not barred from being appointed bishop if he is worthy as regards other matters, because a physical defect is not a real defect, but the real defect is that of the soul. 2. His consecration. The bishop shall be consecrated on Sunday. All the people shall be present at his consecration and act together with the priest as his witnesses. The bishops who come to impose their hands on him shall wash their hands and shall consecrate him. The people standing up in silence and with fear shall raise their hands, and the bishops shall impose their hands on him and say, "We lay our hands upon his chosen servant of God, in the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, so that he may remain in the good and permanent service of the unique and spotless church of the living and invisible God, and may deliver right judgments and show sanctity, pure grace, and faithful teachings. This is a person who is appointed over the congregation of the church by the Holy Trinity with the mystery of the cross. After this, the senior bishop shall impose his hands on him and shall say the prayer of the consecration, and all the people shall say, Amen. Gloss 4. The prayer of consecration is the character we have already mentioned. In the church, there is a book for ordination, and in that book can be found this prayer and other prayers. Then the bishops shall kiss the newly consecrated bishop, and all the priests and all the people shall say, "He is worthy, he is worthy, he is worthy," and all shall kiss him and invoke peace upon him. Then they shall read the scriptural passages appointed for his occasion, and mass shall be celebrated. First, he shall give the holy mystery to himself. Then he shall give it to all those present, according to their rank. Then he shall dismiss them in peace. They shall celebrate a spiritual feast for 3 days, in the likeness of the mystery of him who rose on the third day. After the newly elected bishop receives the approval of all the people, the priest and the bishops shall gather on Sunday, and the senior bishop shall interrogate the priest and deacons and say, "Is this the one who received your approval to be your superior?" And when they answer yes, he shall interrogate them a second time by saying, "Is he worthy of this honored office? Has he behaved well with prudence, and can no blame be imputed to him?" If all answer saying that it is truly so, and that he is truly worthy of the office, and not elected by favoritism, he shall ask them for a third time and say, "Is he truly worthy of this office?" For in the mouth of two or three, every word shall stand. And if for the third time they say he is worthy, all shall stretch and clap their hands. After they do this unanimously, they shall fall silent, and the deacons shall bring the holy gospel and open it on the head of the person to the consecrated, and the bishops shall install him on the chair reserved for him. Since all have accepted him, the Lord also has accepted him. No one shall be consecrated bishop unless another bishop comes from another country, and not him only, but two other bishops with him. And thus one shall be consecrated by three bishops. He shall be consecrated thus. When the gospel is put on his head, the senior bishop shall pray over him. When he finishes praying, he shall impose his hands on him, kiss him, and blow on his face, so that he may be filled with the Holy Spirit. After this, the other priest shall kiss him. The ordinary people shall kiss his hand. Only the bishops and the priests shall kiss him on the mouth. Then they shall finish the mass. We command that bishops be consecrated by three bishops, and in case of necessity by two bishops, but never shall a bishop be consecrated for you by one bishop only, for the testimony of two or three has more weight. If he who imposed him his hands on him was one bishop only, a distinction must be made. If it occurred through necessity or by force, or if it was not possible for the community of the faithful to gather because of a manifest persecution, or for other similar reasons, he may consecrate him alone, but must have the permission of many bishops. They shall permit him to consecrate, and it shall be done pursuant to their order. 3. After his consecration. This aspect is divided into 8 parts. The first is what the newly consecrated bishop must do respect to himself. A bishop shall fast for 3 weeks after his consecration. He shall not taste anything except on the Sabbath of each week. This is done if the period does not fall within the 50 days from the Easter to Pentecost. After this fast, he shall pass 1 year fasting 3 by 3. Gloss 5. I believe it says to fast every day until the end of day from Sunday to Saturday for 3 weeks, and if the rest of the year to fast 3 days every week, that is, on Wednesdays, Fridays, and Mondays. As on Saturdays and Sundays, there is no fast. One cannot fast during a week. 3 days plus 3 days equal to 6 days, while one can fast according to the interpretation given above, that is, 3 days weekly. The food to be taken by the bishop throughout the year of his fasting is bread, salt, oil, honey, and vegetables. He shall not take wine. For the rest of his life, he shall fast as he can, and shall take the food he needs in the proportion required by his physical constitution. However, he must abstain from meat, not because he becomes impure by eating it, but lest his heart become hard and his intelligence become dark and unable to be watchful over his flock, because of the much comfort. In fact, one who wishes to do a bishop's work must choose loneliness, and he who is given to loneliness does not seek any material profit beyond what is necessary for the sustenance of his body. If during the year of fasting the bishop falls victim to an illness which renders him incapable of observing what we have said, he may eat fish and drink wine with moderation for a few days, so that he will not fall, and the church will not be deprived of his rule and teaching. He shall make sure that he receives the mysteries every day, if nothing obstructs him, so that he may always live in them. The bishop must fast only on the days on which all people fast, because if he comes to the church and someone brings something, he must eat with the community. The bishop shall take enough food and drink to sustain himself, so that he will not be too lazy to teach those who are unschooled. A bishop must not be extravagant, nor must he be a wanderer or a rover. His living must not be full of pleasures, nor shall he eat choice food. He shall give himself to teaching with his whole heart. Let him always teach and read the divine books. Let him know well the verses of the holy books in order to be able to explain the books exactly. He shall interpret the gospel, the Pentateuch, the prophets. The Lord has said, "Search and see the scriptures, for they give testimony of me." He must not seek profit, which entails shame, by associating with others, especially with infidels, nor shall he desire to have the greater share. He shall not oppress the people, nor befriend the rich and hate the poor. He must not love one who slanders others, nor shall he testify falsely or be irascible. He shall not stand surety for anyone, nor shall he hunger after the position of the chief, or be double-hearted or double-tongued, nor shall he be one prone to listen to stories. He shall not go to the feast of infidel people, nor shall he love luxury or covet money, for all such things are enemies of God and companions of the devil. He must be wise and prudent, so that he may know evil and avoid it. He shall strive to be beloved by all men. He shall try to be the best of men, because the shepherd, if he stands far from injustice, draws his disciples and encourages them to emulate him in his good works and in truth. In fact, the prophet Hosea said, "How the priest is, thus the people will be." Our good master, Jesus Christus, our God, also first began to do and then to teach, and said, "He that does and teaches shall be called great in the kingdom of heaven." After his consecration, the bishop shall be devoted to the service of the altar and shall pray day and night. And if in every hour he prays for himself and for the people, he does good. He shall be alone in the church. And if there is someone with whom he likes to stay, or if there are two or three persons who are as one soul with him, he shall have them with him so that they may help him in what is necessary. And especially, shall he be accompanied by others during prayer, so that he may pray together with others and beseech the Lord in harmony with others. For the Lord has said, "Where there are two or three gathered together in my name, there am I with them." If he cannot stay in the church continuously, he shall say the canonical hours wherever he is. He shall beseech God wholeheartedly and with every effort, so that the words he utters may bear fruits of the Holy Spirit. He must know every word he teaches and remember that he himself must put each into practice before teaching it, so that he may know exactly what he says, because if he knows what he says, those who hear him shall know what he says to them. The second part deals with what he must do with respect to his people and what he must command them. Apostle Paul said to Timothy, "A bishop and his disciple, I pray thee, first of all, that thou beginnest to make request to God with prayers, supplications, and thanksgiving for all men, that they may stay in patience, quiet, silence, and fear in God, in purity, because these things lead to God, the life-giver, who wishes all men to be saved and to come to the knowledge of his truth. Be thou an example to the faithful in word and in the life of perfection, in charity, in faith, and in chastity. Until I come, attend to reading, to teaching, and to exhortation. Neglect not his grace that is in thee, which was given thee by prophecy, and with the imposition of the bishop's hands. Take heed to thyself, and be whole in these things. For in doing this thou shalt save both thyself and them that hear thee. Rebuke not the aged men, but entreat. Comfort the gladdened, and gladden them as fathers. Rebuke not aged men, but entreat comfort and gladden them as fathers. The young men as thy brethren, old women as mothers, young women as thy sisters in all chastity and honor. With regard to orphans and widows, do according to justice. Against a priest, receive not an accusation unless there is testimony offered by two or three persons. Them that sin, reprove before magistrates, that all men may have fear. Do not do anything through favoritism to either side. Hasten not to impose hands upon anyone, neither to be partaker by this of other men's sins. As for those who have corrupted themselves and have gone astray and consider that the fear of God is a commerce and gain, let thee be far from them. As for us, we have a great gain, that is, the fear of God, along with enough food. We brought nothing into the world, and we know that we cannot carry nothing out from it. Therefore, it is necessary that we take from the world only the food and the clothing that is enough for us. But those who love riches and desire to become rich fall into temptation and into the snare of the devil, and into many conspicuous sins, which lead into error and plunge a person into corruption and perdition. For the desire of money is the root of all evil, and many persons have coveted this and have erred from the faith and have brought themselves into many tribulations. But thou, O man of God, flee these things and pursue justice, uprightness along the path of faith, charity, patience, and humility. Fight for the right and good faith, and thou wilt have the eternal life for which thou art called. Command the rich of this world not to be proud, nor to trust in their riches, in which there is no confidence, but they must trust in the living God who gives us all things in the conspicuousness of his riches for our benefit. Let the faithful be rich in good works, and let them give promptly with equal measure, and lay down for themselves a good foundation for things to come, so that they may hold on the truth of life. O Timothy, keep what is entrusted to thee, and avoid the hearing of vain things and drolleries of lying worlds, because those who seek such things have derived from the faith. Grace be to thee. Amen. Be eager to teach, O bishop, and if you can explain the words taken from all books, satisfy your people and enlighten them with the light of your laws, so that your people may be rich through the abundance of your teachings. And you, O bishops, must be vigilant and watch over the people, for you are the eyes of Christ. And God has said through the prophet Ezekiel, with reference to you, Son of man, I have made thee a watchman of this people, so that thou mayest hear from me the word and announce it to the people, and watch over the people. Since if thou tellest not the sinner to keep away from sin, and if that was given warning, and that sinner dies in his sin, I will require his blood from thy hands. But if thou hast given warning to the sinner from the beginning and hast spoken to dissuade him from doing evil, and he converts not and dies in his sin, thou hast delivered thy soul. Therefore, teach those who live without knowledge and comfort those who are learned. Bring to the truth those who have erred and speak to them always about their error. Maintain yourself, O bishop, in purity in all your works. And the eyes, and know the degree of your dignity, since because of your dignity you are like God in the eyes of the people, and have become chief over the people and over all the kings, the judges, and the priests, the parents and their children who are learned, and over all those who are subject to your command. Stay in your church and preach the divine word, since you have the power to judge the sinners. Indeed to you, O bishops, Christ has said, whatever you shall bind in earth shall be bound also in heaven. Judge with power similar to God's, except whoever repents, because the Lord is a God of mercy. Reproach whoever sins, and drive not away him who does penance. Take care, O bishop, of the salvation of every man. As to you, our Lord has said, see that you despise not any one of these little ones, and know by that he will want you to account for whatever was entrusted to you. Moreover, you have to know that he who has had much in trust will be asked for much. Be blameless, so that no one will be scandalized because of you. A layman cares for himself, but you have carried a great burden. It is written that God said to Moses, thou and Aaron shall bear the sins of the heedless people. Teach those who are heedless, and know that you will have a great reward if you do it, as well as a great punishment if you neglect it. If one who has a great sin comes to you, neglect him not. In connection with the bishop who neglects his people, the prophet Ezekiel has said, woe to the shepherds of Israel who left their sheep to feed alone. Are you not the shepherds who feed the flocks? You drink the milk, and you clothe yourselves with the wool, and kill that which was fat. But you look not after my flock. You strengthen not the weak. You heal not the broken. You seek not the strayed. You recover not the lost. You teach them not with love, but with derision. My sheep were scattered because there was no shepherd, and they became the food of the lions of the desert. And he also said, I will judge between sheep and shepherd, and between male and goats. And he who has sinned, whom you, O bishop, have driven away with excommunication, do not leave him out, but bring him back to the church. Seek him who is astray, and him who hopes for salvation, because of the great number of his sins. You shall not leave him to be lost completely. Thus also the bishop must,